How many spies do you think we have within the United States now? And is it easier because of high tech and the internet and social media, is it easier to gain information for the enemy, so to speak? Is it easier to change the ideology, you know, that we have here? Because, you know, my thinking is this: every great nation that we know of, at least in my learning of history, it's always been conquered first from within. It's weakened from within.
Yep.
And then it becomes viable for a conquest. Do you see that happening now? I mean,
all right. So this is multiple questions. Let me just answer the question with how many spies we have in the United States.
Jack Philip Barsky, born Albert Dietrich, I think I have that right, 13th of November, 1949, is a German-American author, IT specialist, and former sleeper agent of the KGB, who spied on the United States from 1978 to 1988. Exposed after the Cold War, Barsky became a resource for U.S. counterintelligence agencies and was allowed to remain in the United States. His autobiography, Deep Undercover, was published in 2017, and he frequently speaks on his experiences and as an expert on espionage. Jack, welcome.
Well, thanks for having me. I've been looking forward to this moment for quite some time. Are you actually back in the U.S.?
Yeah, I'm here now in Southern California. That's where I live.
Nice place to be. Actually, I'm going to be in Southern California in August, speaking at a church in Cyprus.
In Cyprus, wow. Okay, it's possible I've been to that church. I've been to so many out here, but what's the date in August, Jack?
I have to email you that. It's the middle of August, and you know, you're certainly invited to attend this. I'm going to give my testimony, which is not as much out in public because none of the big secular like hosts want to talk about it.
Really?
Yeah, I offered the picture of my baptism to 60 Minutes, and they politely declined.
Yeah, well, you know what? I'm not too surprised about that. But, you know, unfortunately, I'm going to be in the United Kingdom. I'm doing a 25-city tour beginning July 2nd. So I'll be there until the end of August. So I'll miss you that time. But where do you, well, maybe we'll catch up, you know.
All right, no problem.
But anyway, let's get into this. You know, one of the reasons I'm fascinated in my former life, Cosa Nostra Mafia, we were always concerned about spies, which we called informants, but spies and informants, kind of interchangeable. And we were kind of always on the lookout for them, you know, in different ways. We were careful who we spoke to. We would, you know, if we just met somebody, we had to put them through a process to know that they could be trusted and we could bring them around. So it was always, it was fascinating to me. And, you know, we had two kinds of informants. Number one, we had undercover FBI agents like Joe Pistone, who was, you know, brilliantly for 6 years, he remained undercover. Shame on us, but that happened. And then we have defectors kind of from within, like a Greg Scarper, a Willie Boy Johnson, that were actually part of the life, but were also informing to the government for years and years and years, undetected. We didn't know it. So I'm familiar with spying or informants in that regard and was always leery of them. But your story is fascinating. Tell us how this all began with you. I mean, I know you were born in East Germany. How did it begin?
Yeah, well, I was born into 4 years after the end of World War II. And I was born into the poorest section of all of Germany. It was Soviet occupied, but at that corner where I grew up was like as poor as it got. There was really nothing happening there. But I managed to get out of there because the Lord gave me a halfway decent brain. You know, I did well in school and I did very well in high school. I graduated with all A's. I had a choice of college and studied chemistry, and I did really well there as well. I graduated as valedictorian, and I also got a national scholarship that was limited to 100 concurrent recipients at the time. So that was a big one. And based on that track record, and you know, you grow up under communist brainwashing, you have no choice. You become a communist yourself. The idea of, you know, this wonderful paradise on earth where everybody is equal, it's very appealing to young people. And you know, I bought it hook, line, and sinker. So in those days in East Germany, there was a file on everybody. And I believe, and I reconstruct this, that when the KGB was looking for raw material, that people that could become undercover agents, they just went. They were allowed to look through the files, and I was a standout. I mean, and so they knocked on the door. I'm short. I'm not telling the whole story in detail. But, you know, people can find it in the book. They knocked on the door. When I was asked if I had an interest, I played along because I was curious. I want to see what happens. A year and a half it took for me, having an informal relationship with the person who was my handler at that time, before they actually made the offer for employment. A year and a half, because they had to figure out whether I fit the mold. It isn't just brains. It isn't just bravery, lack of fear. There's one of the favorite character traits that I found they were looking for is well-controlled inclination for adventure. Wow. The ability to operate on, make decisions quickly, be by yourself for a long period of time, and on and on and on. And in the year and a half, the fellow that worked with me concluded I had what it takes, and he was right. You know, I was pretty successful with regard to, you know, I operated altogether. I operated for 10 years undetected, and then it took the FBI another 5 years to find me, and they found me only because there was a defector from the KGB archives. So yeah, I fit the description. That doesn't mean that I'm arrogant enough to say I'm a better person than most everybody else. No, I'm just different. And you know, the well-controlled inclination for adventure degraded into recklessness occasionally.
So so Jack, very interesting what you said. So you bought in as a young man. You bought into the communist ideology, hook, line, and sinker. Everybody's Absolutely. Equal. It was appealing to you. Is that correct?
Yep.
Because you know, I really want you to comment on this. As you know, I'm sure you follow our politics and what's going on in this country. We have now these democratic socialists who are trying to, the progressives that are trying to spread that ideology throughout the country. And I think it's a lot of young people that are buying into it, this equality deal. Please comment on that, Jack, and how you feel about that. And, is it great? Is it dangerous? What do you think?
The comparison between the leaders of the Communist Party in East Germany, where I grew up, and the Democratic Socialists, the Americans will not appear with a lot of praise because they are dreamers and they're idiots. Mm. Okay, the communists in East Germany were not idiots. They were smart people. They were focused, and they actually got stuff done. When the wall was erected in 1961, it was an incredibly difficult logistical operation to get this done in a day and a half or whatever. The democratic socialists that we have in the United States don't have a clue how to get anything done. And we now have a central government, the federal government, that everything they touch, just like they mess it up, because they're just like, they live in their own world and have never really succeeded in life. And so now we're burdened with that nonsense.
You know, it's amazing you said that, because I recently wrote a book, Mafia Democracy, and I go into the ideology that I see in our government that's so similar to the way we operated on the street. It's very Machiavellian. And you said something now. You know, I feel the same way. When somebody is in a government, you know, getting a government salary for 45, 46, 47 years, it's like something happens, you know, inside of them. They don't know how to work anymore. You know, in this administration, it feels like, exactly like you said, they just can't get anything done. Nothing seems to be going right. But, you know, this is what we're faced with right now, and hopefully people get to understand that. People like yourself talk about it, who've experienced that kind of lifestyle and that kind of ideology will prevail.
May I add something which is rather pessimistic? And I'm at heart an optimist. You know, I wouldn't have taken on this job to go into enemy territory and spy there if I wasn't convinced that everything would be okay. Yeah. Okay, so I'm an optimist, but what I'm looking at now in the United States, I think a reversal of where we are going, and we're going in the wrong direction, is very difficult to achieve, and I'm telling you why. It has nothing to do with the current government. It has nothing to do with some of the idiot socialists. It has something to do that now we have at least two generations that have been educated and brainwashed to believe things that are not true. We're talking, you know, the school and the universities. How do you fix that? Because I know for a fact that what you are being taught as a young person, it is extremely difficult to overcome. Because there's contemporaries of mine who I've met when I went back to Germany, who were just like me, communists, and they still are at heart, even though they had all the opportunity to research, to figure out what happened. It's going to be an uphill battle. I'm serious.
Well, Jack, let me ask you this. You're an expert in espionage. How is it that this ideology has been able to infiltrate our education system over the past, maybe you're right, one or two decades? How is it possible that they've been able to do that? What kind of movement is going on? What's happening in this country to allow that?
Okay, now, the one thing I am not a proponent of is the idea that somehow this undermining was started by the KGB, by the Soviet Union, and the seeds were seeded. The reason I'm saying that is because the KGB didn't have a clue how America functions. I had personal experience, because the ones that were trained me gave me nothing but bad advice. They had no clue. They didn't know what it was like to be an American. They didn't know how American society functioned. And vice versa, by the way, the CIA didn't understand the Soviet Union either. So it is my theory, and this is sort of where empires go over time. America has become fat, dumb, and happy, or you can also say, depending upon the mood, fat, dumb, and angry. When you have more to lose than to gain, you become complacent. The edge that America had as a country, the seeking of adventure and the doing better for yourself and doing better for the country, that has disappeared. We're now playing defense. We have too much to lose. And, you know, I've seen this in corporate America. I spent 30 plus years in corporate. And, you know, the higher up they are, the less willing they are, in many companies, willing they are to make decisions, because they could go wrong. And if they go wrong, they lose their job, right? So this is this complacency and the fear. If I go out there on a limb, if I take accountability, it could be wrong, and then I lose everything. And I think that's a big one. That's really the big one.
Yeah, you know, I agree with that. It's funny that you say that. You know, I'm involved a bit in the entertainment industry, and when you're trying to get a project done and you're bringing it to a studio, it's so much easier for them to say no than it is to say yes. Because if they say no, well, it's over at that point, even if somebody else picks it up and has a success with it. But if they say yes and it fails, well, you spent a lot of money, time, effort, and, you know, the onus goes on you. So a lot of times it's a lot easier to say no. So I understand that, you know, very well. And that's interesting. So we have more to lose than we do to gain, is what you're saying.
Yes. And here's the thing, you know, like you don't have to look too far into the situation. The phenomenal fear that was generated by this COVID virus is just unprecedented, where people have done and still do stupid things. Doctor's office, you go to the doctor and you must put a mask on. It doesn't matter that the mask that you're using has been proven to be completely useless, but you still must put a mask on, because somebody is afraid that, you know, if they don't implement that particular idiotic measure, they might get fired. It's just totally amazing. Or people, you know, walking in the park with a mask on, driving in a vehicle with a mask on. That's raw fear.
Well, I agree with you, Jack. I see no sense in it either. Even in some restaurants now, they're still wearing masks, you know, long after this issue has been resolved, really. I mean, people are not worried about it. But I don't know. I agree with you. But look at how they were able to instill that fear in people. that still exists now, even though COVID is basically not a real threat anymore to anyone. But yeah, I agree with that. But let me ask you this.
May I explain something, how this happened?
Yeah, please do.
Because I about a year and a half ago, I wrote an essay called The Age of Unreason. America has forgotten how to think. And it starts again in school. The school system is focusing on learning facts, not learning how to think and to have a discussion, an argument about, you know, seeking the truth. And so when people, for instance, would say during COVID, I follow the science, they didn't have a clue what that means.
Yeah.
Because science is not, this is what we know and it's over. The science has been settled. No, science is always looking for the truth. And man is so, so far away from finding the truth. So if you cannot, the only thing that can defeat fear is reason. And people don't know how to reason anymore.
Yeah. No, I think that's a great explanation. I really mean that, because some people, I'll ask them, I've been in a restaurant and I'll say, why are you wearing a mask? I can't even understand what you're saying to me. Well, we have to. They don't even want to do it. They don't even know the reason why. We have to. That's the answer. But let me ask you this, Jack. What was it that caused you to accept the invitation to become, you know, a spy? Was it a hate? Because you were, you know, grew up under communism and communist ideology, was it a hatred of the U.S. System? Was it intrigue? Was it just, hey, this is adventurous and I want to do it? What was the reason?
It was a mix. The only hatred that I've ever felt in my heart is the hatred for the German Nazis, because we were shown what they did. I was in my junior year, my class was a requirement. We visited a concentration camp, and what we saw there, like, it was just horrendous, you know, piles of corpses. And some shrunken heads. I mean, real shrunken heads, not pictures of shrunken heads.
Sure.
And so I so hated that I could not believe how man can do that to man. I didn't hate the United States, but the United States supported West Germany. And in West Germany, there were some ex-Nazis in government. That was the ideological foundation. Yeah, I wanted to help defeat the Nazis. And the other thing was clearly the sense of adventure. Definitely, you know, I wanted to travel. And I wanted, and you know, and I felt really good about being recruited by the KGB when you're like in your 20s and this powerful organization says, we like you, we want you. I said, yes. And I became so full of myself. And it took a long time to get rid of that, you know, focus on self and the thought that I, you know, I was just like way above everybody else, that it disappeared when I found God, for sure.
Wow. You know, I tell you, Jack, I agree. My study of history, I think that at a point in time, we can say the Nazis were the most evil force on planet Earth for the way they conducted themselves. I mean, it was.
But you know, Stalin and the Soviet Union and Mao and Communist China weren't that far behind. You know, Stalin killed a lot of his own citizens.
Yeah.
Since we're now at a time when Russia is fighting Ukraine, you know that Stalin pretty much killed about 4 million Ukrainians by starving them to death because they resisted the collectivization. So I figured, you know, I'd just kill them all. Horrible scenes there too, but not as well documented.
Really? Wow. Let me ask you this. Do you believe the Russians had anything to do with compromising the 2016 election here in the United States?
This was my first interview ever on cable TV, and I was asked that question with regard to, was there some collusion, or did the Russians really want to have Hillary as the president? And I said, I don't think so. What the Russians were doing with a vengeance is trying to make the rift that it already was in society, make it bigger. In that respect, they have done quite well, and it's still ongoing. You know, I have a background in information technology, and I have a lot of folks who are very knowledgeable in cyber war and so forth. There's a lot of estimates that say that about 20% of what you find on Facebook is manufactured, and a lot of that is manufactured by Russians. So this was really the focus, and I think the argument makes sense, because the relationship between the Obama government and Russia wasn't that good either. Now, after the reset, it all went down the hill, and there was no indication that Donald Trump would do any better. So I don't think they wanted to have Trump as a president. And if they did, they regretted it, because he actually got pretty tough, even though he always talked this soft. He said, I love Vladimir Putin. I get along with him. You know, maybe deep down inside a little bit, because, you know, he likes to be the all-powerful individual. But he just talked sweet talk to dictators. I think that was not the right approach. But, you know, the actions of the Trump government spoke louder than Trump's words.
What do you think is driving Putin? I mean, we hear different things. That number one, he's concerned about, you know, NATO allies on his border. He wants to bring back the Soviet Union. You know, here there's paranoia in him. What do you think is driving him to do what he's done?
Since, I forgot exactly the year, but it was more than a dozen years ago, Putin has been an open book with regard to what his agenda was going to be. He went on record. There was a conference in Switzerland where he gave a speech, and he said, you know, it is his goal to reestablish a greater Russia. You know, the Russia, and so unite all the Russian-speaking folks and recreate the glory that he thought and they think was once Russia under, say, Peter the Great. It wasn't that glorious, okay? Under Peter the Great, Russia was a state mostly populated by peasants and had mostly agriculture. And Stalin actually forced the industrialization of the Soviet Union. And that didn't go so well either, because their industry is still not really capable. It's just there was no organic growth. Anyway, so getting back to the question, Vladimir Putin has, and as part of that overall strategy, is taking little bites when he thinks he can. So he took Crimea. The Obama government didn't even sneeze. Okay. And now he thought it would be time to take Ukraine. And that's obviously miscalculation for sure. But you know what? He and his intelligence services and everybody in the West thought it would be a walkover. Yeah, well, they didn't know that Ukrainian people are incredibly proud and have a long memory of what happened, what Stalin did to Ukraine. The bottom line is you cannot conquer a country and win a war if you fight the entire population. The United States found that out in Vietnam. And we had a much stronger military than the Russians. And yet, you know, women and children fought the U.S. Army. This is a situation now, I think, where neither Ukraine nor Russia is winning, because Ukraine is not winning. They're losing a lot of people, that's civilians. And Russia is not making that progress, and they're losing a lot of soldiers. And in that process, they are weakening their own military. And I've been on TV many times, and I get the question, so what do you see? Where is this going? And I said, I have no idea. It's going to take a long time for something to happen when people stop shooting. And just in case Putin manages to take over a sizable chunk of Ukraine or install a puppet regime, it's not over. It will be then like Afghanistan squared. And you know that the Afghanistan situation was the beginning of the end of the Soviet Union.
Jack, you think Putin would have invaded Ukraine if Trump was in office?
I believe not, because Donald Trump was unpredictable and he made tough decisions. I think not. I think it was during the election campaign when you heard the person that we call president mumble and stumble through a bunch of speeches or whatever, you know, question and answer. You knew that there was incredible weakness, intellectual as well as, you know, overall courage. He's an empty shell.
Biden is. You know the way the governments work. Do you think Biden is really in control of what's going on here?
And I said, you know, I talked about the incompetence. There are probably, I don't know how many, and we don't know who they are. Some people probably have good guesses. I don't. But there are a number of competent people in the government that have an agenda, and they're controlling the sock puppet in the White House. But they're not visible, okay? They don't have positions of power, but they wield that power, I believe, by influencing our president and making him think that he's doing incredibly well, and he might go into history as like a JFK or an FDR, right? Because he's changing the United States to make it better.
Well, you know what? The sad thing about that is after 47 years in government, if he on his own can't see what's happening and that the decisions that he are making are certainly not benefiting this country, then something is incredibly wrong there. Let me ask you this. You know, we all have this paranoia now, not paranoia, but we all have this concern because we keep hearing that, you know, Putin is a wild card also. And if he really thinks he's losing ground,
yep,
he wouldn't hesitate to use a nuclear weapon. What do you feel about that?
And that is when this war started. That was the first thing I was talking about. There is concern about that. But it's not necessarily Putin purposely doing this. You know, there's Putin rhetoric, and we know he talks like a tough guy. And then we have politicians in the United States, you know, the armchair warriors, who, you know, our president called Putin a war criminal. Did that move the needle someplace? No, that's a political statement. You know, he wanted to see, to appear tough. There are some Republicans who do it too. It's the politicians. And every time, this is one of my favorite things to say, every time politics dominates foreign policy, you know, I'm going to make wrong decisions. And here's where I'm talking about this is dangerous. The rhetoric escalates the tension. And with higher tension, there's a better chance of mistakes being made, even mistakes in thinking, or, you know, when it's really tense, you might just make a damn mistake and explode one of those bombs. And now what?
Yeah.
This is a very, very dangerous times that we live in right now.
Would you say in your experience, are these the most dangerous of times that you've experienced during your lifetime, at least with respect to the United States?
Somewhat comparable to the situation when the Berlin Wall was erected. And I know the history of this, and there was a good chance of actually Soviet troops and American troops actually engaging. And there were some situations where they were actually standing next to each or opposing each other in tanks here and tanks there. So that was dangerous. There were also the Cuban Missile Crisis was probably the worst.
Yeah.
In that time frame, there was a nuclear submarine that was outside of Cuba. Okay, so this is what happened. The Americans saw that there was a submarine, and they released a depth charge, which required the submarine to appear. And so they actually had the ability to decide as to whether to shoot a nuclear missile onto the U.S. mainland. And the top guy said, no, we're not going to do it. So similar, you know, mistakes. Yeah. And so I think there were, as I said, two, three situations during the Cold War when we were in similar danger.
Let me ask you this. First question, do you think there is a real alliance between Russia and China right now, and that they have a common goal of somehow overcoming, I don't know if I'm using the right word, defeating, overcoming, taking over principal power here in the world from the United States?
This is a marriage of convenience. Anything to weaken NATO and the United States, that makes them allies. But let's just, for argument's sake, imagine that NATO just becomes meaningless and the Western world loses its capability to lead the planet. At that point, the two players will oppose each other because they have different goals. And the Chinese are much bigger and stronger. I mean, Russia is a nothing economically. And the only reason that they are able to buy stuff that they can't produce themselves is because of they have natural resources. But their economy is number 11 or 12 in the world. And it's weaker than Italy. So the only reason that you have to worry about them is that they have the nukes. And they share a pretty long common border. And there have been skirmishes along that border for many, many years. So they don't really like each other, but they hate the United States, and they want to make the world into a Eastern dominated type planet, you know, where the East dominates and the West is kaput.
Well, it's a marriage of convenience unless it becomes inconvenient, basically.
That's exactly right. Yes, I believe so.
Let me ask you this again, Jack, because I think people are interested in this. You know, I would assume to a great degree, Russia's nuclear capability. If, God forbid, there ever was that mistake, that accident, something happened, who do you think would prevail? I mean, obviously, there's a loser on both sides because nuclear war is devastating, but who do you think would prevail? Would anybody prevail? What would the outcome be?
I don't think you can win a nuclear war, even though I got to be really careful. This is all hearsay and, you know, what I heard other people talk about. Even though the United States has better defensive weapons, and that's thanks to Ronald Reagan and Star Wars. Okay, so we have the ability to actually do damage from satellites, and I believe the Russians don't have that. But ultimately, it's like Ukraine. Nobody can win there. A nuclear war, you can't win because there will be destruction everywhere. That's sort of, the situation. You ever saw the movie Mad Max?
Yes.
That's what I see the world might become if we are firing nukes at each other.
Well, you know, you would hope that even a Putin, who, you know, is basically a mad hatter, sometimes out of control, would at least think of that and say, there's no winner here. What am I doing? You know, but who knows? You know, it's something that we have to live with now.
Well, I think there's something to be said here. As aggressive the Soviet leadership was, Soviet Union, none of them wanted to die. They're not suicidal. I don't think Vladimir Putin is suicidal. If his mental health deteriorates to a point where he doesn't care anymore, he doesn't know what he's doing anymore, one would hope that there are some procedures, some rules in place that would allow other people who are high up in the military, whatever, in government, who don't want to die to override the suicidal guy. It's not like, for instance, Iran, where they all want to die. They think that's the end goal for them. And so, you get to heaven and you get to sleep with 30 virgins and all that. Russia isn't wired that way. Okay, so there's some hope.
Wow. Well, that's good to hear. Yeah, that even if he does lose his mind a little bit, there'll be people around him that'll control it. And
as I said, they don't want to die. There's no desire to sacrifice yourself for a greater cause. So in that respect, thank God, the Russians are still rational human beings.
Let me ask you this, Jack. From your experience, how many spies do you think we have within the United States now? And is it easier because of high tech and the internet and social media, is it easier to gain information for the enemy, so to speak? Is it easier to change the ideology, that we have here? Because, my thinking is this: every great nation that we know of, at least in my, learning of history, it's always been conquered first from within. It's weakened from within. Yep. And then it becomes viable for a conquest. Do you see that happening now? I mean,
all right. So this is multiple questions. Let me just answer the question with how many spies we have in the United States. I'm going to tell you a lot. Okay, but not people like me. Simply because we were extremely difficult and expensive to train and to maintain. Like, Russia doesn't need illegals as much as the Soviet Union thought they needed illegals, because in those days, in my days, there was almost no real openness between the United States and the Soviet Union. There was very little, there were very few people from the Soviet Union coming to the United States officially as students, as business people, as scientists, and so forth. Now this is like, it's very fluid. You got lots of Russians in the United States and even a lot more Chinese, and both countries pretty much control who is allowed to go to Western countries. So when they leave, they'll be asked, can you help out the motherland? And enough of them say yes. And they're not well trained. When you see the ones that have been caught lately, like particularly this young lady, I think Maria Butina, I don't know if that was the right first name, but she had absolutely no training. Because she communicated with Moscow through social media. She had not even the basic training. So, and that sort of is something that Vladimir Putin doesn't mind. He doesn't mind if some of his agents are caught. because that raises then the question, how many more are there? Right. And, you know, just the intimidation factor compared to the Soviet Union, the KGB really was very, very protective of their agents. They panicked when they thought, you know, I was about to be caught, which wasn't true. They proactively said, it's come on home. We don't want you to be caught. So that's, that was part of the question. The other part is, yes, it is has become a lot easier to steal secrets in the day and age of the internet. Hacking is all over the place, and Americans are really not well trained to do the right thing.
Jack, excuse me, can you repeat that? You froze for a second, so we didn't really hear you.
Okay, so
you're answering the second question.
Yeah, with regard to does the internet and cyber technology make it easier to steal secrets? Absolutely does. The population of the United States is incredibly sloppy when it comes to operating on the internet, whether they are doing this on the job or they're doing it, you know, on Facebook or Twitter or whatever. We don't know what cyber hygiene is. We don't teach kids in school how to behave when they get their first iPhone, nothing. And so most of the hacks, successful hacks, are, you know, start with human error. Now we have this other thing that is growing, and that's the avatars, the artificial people that are now operating on, they don't exist, but they look like real people. I just found two of them that wanted to connect with me on LinkedIn. They were absolutely phony. Those individuals, and they are not really individuals, they were just avatars. They continue what the KGB started, you know, with other media, you know, print media, or radio, television. It's called active measures. Create confusion in the country of in the target country. And so what they're doing now on social media, these avatars attach themselves to extremist groups, left or right, doesn't matter. And then they feed those groups. There's even one instance that has been documented where an avatar was able to organize a protest march. I think it was for Black Lives Matter, even though he didn't exist. But he had enough friends to tell him, you know, I'm not doing well, but you're going to go there and talk to everybody, and you have some posters printed. And there was a protest march. So,
and who creates the avatar? How is that? How is the avatar created?
Nerds. We know that there's an organization called the Internet Research Agency, which is housed in St. Petersburg. And there's a couple of hundred people there who day in, day out work on these, creating these creatures and then manipulating them. And they are significantly more successful today because there's a whole lot more knowledge in Russia how the United States functions. You know, these people know what they're doing, whereas, you know, in the old days, the active measures that the KGB tried to implement, most of them failed because of ignorance. But I just got to tell you that the United States is playing that game as well. You have to. Okay, we're just not loud about it. I have a couple of friends who are, they're good guys, but they know how to create avatars that are extremely difficult to unmask, so to speak. These are entities that have phone numbers, social security numbers, attorneys, a bank account. It's amazing what you can do when you operate on the dark web. And you go ahead.
No, I said it's amazing. It's fascinating what you're saying. It's the internet has become such a tool for espionage, basically.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. And the undermining, again that's under the heading of active measures, the undermining of the enemy society has become a lot easier. We have like two extremes on the left and on the right. We're talking about Black Lives Matter over here and QAnon over there. And they believe in what they want to believe, and they can be driven even further to the extremes. And that's not good.
Yeah. Well, you know, in the case of Black Lives Matter, it's been shown, you know, in recent months that this was just it's a phony organization, bottom line. And the way they've used their funds and the things that they're not doing to help, you know, Black right. America, it's a tragedy what happened there. But yeah, I have a question, you know, curiosity. You understand how government works and their ideology in a big way. What's happening at our southern border? Wide open borders, let anybody in. What do you feel the reasoning behind that? What is the administration's reasoning behind allowing people to come in over our southern borders and then dispersing them throughout cities within the United States? What's your feeling on that?
I don't know if their reasoning is actually sound, but the only explanation there is like create more individuals that are dependent on government, and that's why you're going to move them into cities. They're easier controlled when they have government housing and all of this. So it's a power play, not necessarily. I don't think there's an immediate expectation that they create more Democrat voters, because it's going to take a while, but that could be in the long run. But it's just to create to the ranks of the underclass that is not independent anymore.
And why would they want to do that, Jack? I mean,
that's all about ruling. It's about, power. I can actually relate to this a little bit because, when I grew up and I was as good as I was, I knew I was going to be one of the rulers of society. And I thought it was a good idea because I was smarter than everybody else. So the dumb people underneath needed to be told how to be happy. And so this is the ideology that comes out of the left. And I understand this. And they, a lot of them are actually honest about this, the way I was honest about it. And then there are, of course, those who about nothing but raw power.
So in your estimation, they allow these people to come in to be dependent upon them, yep. And they want to maintain themselves as the ruling class. They want to stay in control.
Yes, absolutely. And, this is not the same as, when people think, socialism and communism is just around the corner. That's not going to work because we have like very powerful corporations that won't just, the state will own the corporations. So we're looking at potential oligarchs. And the book title of your new book indicates we're talking about a criminal enterprise at the highest level.
Well, that's how I see it, Jack. I mean, yeah. I do. I mean, look, on the street, it was all about maintaining power and control. And how do you do that? By controlling the underclass, by making people dependent upon you.
Yep.
And I see it happening in our government. So I thank you for just corroborating that for me.
No, I got to read this book. When I saw the announcement and I read the title, I said, oh, my God, he's going to get canceled. As a matter of fact, we both might get canceled now.
I'll tell you what happened, Jay. I was going to write that book 6 years ago for my publisher. And I wrote about four chapters, and I turned to my wife at one point in time, and I said, what do I need this for? I said, nobody's bothering me now. I live a good life. And I know these people could be very vengeful if they see something they don't like and, try to compromise me in some way. So I stopped writing the book. And I went to my publisher and I said, I'm not going to write it. I gave him back the advance. I said, that's it. But I feel a responsibility. In the last year or so, I felt a responsibility because I see this government deteriorating in a way that's really troublesome, for the future of my kids and my grandkids. That's what I'm concerned about.
Yeah. Made a key statement. I have adult children who still have a pretty long life ahead of them, and I have an 11-year-old. And my 11-year-old is just as independent-minded as I am. She will not kowtow to the ones who rule and might wind up having a miserable life as a result.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's what we have to be concerned about. It's just not the same America I grew up in. There's no doubt about it. And it's heading in the wrong direction as far as I'm concerned. I'm like you, Jack. I'm the eternal optimist. But I really am. I think, things are going to be okay. We're going to move it in the right direction. It's going to work out all right. But I'm also a realist. And, being an optimist doesn't mean that you see things as they are and realize that, hey, this may not work out. It's not under my control. This may not work out. But I'm very concerned about the future of this country. Now, let me get to some good stuff now. You meet this woman. She's obviously had an impact on you. Same way, I'm a street guy. I meet a woman. I fall in love with her. Her and her mom are devout Christians. And here I am, all these years later, a follower of Christ and, the best transition I've ever made in my life. How did this happen to you? How is it affecting your life? What do you think? I mean, love to hear it.
I hired her. So this I needed a. I was a CIO of a pretty sizable electric energy company, and I needed a new administrative assistant. And she was one of the candidates. And this is absolutely no exaggeration. The moment I looked at her for the first time, it was love at first sight.
We have that in common.
It never happened before. And you know, I love beautiful women. I've always like admired beautiful women, but I've never once been fallen in love just by opening the door and there she sits and my jaw didn't drop, but it might as well have dropped. And went, now I was at the time in a divorce situation. I was in a crisis and I was really rather depressed. That was the only time in my life I suffered from severe depression. And so obviously she's younger than me and she's my employee. So there's no way that I was going to pursue her actively, but I did it softly and gently. And we got to know each other very well because that company had an open seating arrangement and she was sitting diagonally from me on the other side of a long bench. She found out how I treat people. So, but now this interesting thing is that she told me later that God told her there was a task for her at that company, but she didn't know what the task was and who the target was. It started with me and has nothing to do with pursuing a love relationship. I just did what I always did with employees. I wanted to see what talents they might have that would help them grow. So, and she was a really good writer. When she wrote business emails, they were excellent. She had served in the United Nations for a while. So she was very diplomatic and elegant. And then one day I said to her, you know, and she told me that she attended Bible school in the evening. And one day I said to her, can you show me something that you wrote, an essay, so I can see how well you write overall? And interestingly enough, I picked an essay about the book of Ruth that, you know, we're talking about very subtle movements in the direction of Christianity, because the book of Ruth can be read as a story. You know, there's not much evangelism in it. And I had a moment of enlightenment. I said, my God, I said to her, okay, this is really good. But now I think I need to read the original to see if you did it justice. Out came the Bible. Now for the first time in my entire life, I was already in my 50s, I opened the Bible and read something in there. And then while I was reading the book of Ruth, I said, wait a minute, this is the book, and I knew that much, that is has had the most readers in history, period, with no other book a close second. And I didn't know what was in it. You know, this is a knowledge gap. I always prided myself on, you know, having a lot of knowledge about a lot of different things, and I didn't know anything about this thing. So I asked her if I could keep the Bible, and she was prepared for that. Mm. She gave me a set of CDs. So now I'm listening, you know, starting from, you know, the Old Testament. I'm listening to the entire Bible series. I had a one-hour commute each way, so I would listen this in my car. We both know that there's a lot of text in the Bible that is not that easy to understand, that requires explanation, that it requires historic background and so forth, that I could ask these questions of. So we decided that to set aside a couple of mornings prior to the start of the business day, so 8 o'clock, and we put on our calendar, preparation for the workday or something like that. We now call it jokingly undercover Bible study. And here comes the next step. You know, she was smart enough to know, she was already evangelizing me, you know, and I sort of figured this. And one day we were out to lunch together and we drove back to the office. And I said to her, listen, you know, I respect your religion and I have no problem with that. But if you think that I would ever become a Christian, you're wrong. And she blurted out, you're already a Christian, you just don't know it. One day she tells me, there's this radio program, you really need to listen to it. And the radio program was called Let My People Think. The apologist who ran this was Ravi Zacharias, who is unfortunately has done some bad things in his life, but that doesn't mean it only means he was a human being. He's passed away, but it doesn't in any way, shape, or form invalidate what he spoke of and what he wrote. So first time I'm turning this on, it looks like the topic was picked just for me. And you know, probably when sometimes when we go to church, the pastor talks to us. He talked to me because he talked about morality, and I had trouble to sort of come to grips with the fact that I thought of myself as a good person, but I had done a lot of bad things. And so morality was really something that I was struggling with. And so Dr. Zacharias said, you know, morality doesn't come from the inside. It's coming from the outside. It's coming from God. And I knew it hadn't come from the inside. And, you know, I had learned to live by the rules of society. If I had relied on only my own self, I would have never changed. And then he went one step further, saying, well, where there is a moral law, there has to be a lawgiver. And, you know, it was very convincing. It was a logical argument that, and so I would listen to this guy, Dr. Zacharias, from and to work when he was on. And then I was introduced to C.S. Lewis, and I read a couple of C.S. Lewis' books. I even took a course on C.S. Lewis. And so what happened to me, I became a deist. The apologetic logic is so forcing, C.S. Lewis particularly, but also Dr. Zacharias. I read two of his books that it really occurred to me what an idiot I was not to have believed in God. You know, it's just the whole idea that, you know, the universe was at first nothing, and then it exploded and organized itself to create everything that we see outside and everything that who we are, that is against science, right?
Yes.
Jack, I got to stop you at this point because it's amazing to me. You came to the conclusion that God is God and Jesus is Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Through logic, research, reason, and evidence. And you know, our coming to Christ is so similar in that regard because I came the same way. But here's what I love the statements you just made. You know, I say this oftentimes that am I supposed to believe that some little speck of nothing that nobody can explain where it really came from, that's not science, they can't explain it, all of a sudden just on its own exploded into what it exploded into, everything. It makes no sense. There's no logic behind it. But here's what I need to do now, Jack. I need to stop you because I'm going to ask if we can do this again, but really just talk about our faith. I mean, we'll do this part two. Because there's too much here, and we're already in this an hour.
Okay.
But I would love to do that if you're open to it.
No, absolutely. And you know, we also have this in common. We, when possible, I appear in churches and you know, give my testimony. And sometimes you know, it helps believers strengthen their faith because everybody's doubts now and then when things don't go well and you think, you know, God really doesn't love you. My story really does well amongst believers and to some degree non-believers as well.
I can tell you this, Jack, I would love to, I'm thinking this as we're talking, get on a stage together with you.
I was thinking about that.
I mean it, because we've come to Christ, so our backgrounds were so different, but yet we've come to Christ in the same way. And I think, you know, people like to hear logical explanations to things. I think that's something you and I are going to explore if you're open to it. But this is the first of more encounters, you and I, without a doubt. I think this might have been a divine encounter.
You know, again, when I first stumbled upon your existence, I said, I got to meet this guy.
And when I heard about you, I said the same thing. And I know it took a while. You know, I've been so jammed with traveling, Jack, because I'm doing this tour and the book just came out and I got a stage play and a television series. So much stuff is happening. So I've been crazy for the past couple of months. But, you know, hopefully when I get back from the United Kingdom, things will calm down a bit. But we'll start to put them together and see how we can make this happen. I think it would be tremendously impactful in the churches. You know, look, two is better than one. Two guys from the furthest we could be from Christ at some point in time come together through logic, reason, experience, evidence, You know, I always say I came to Christ through evidence. That's what got me sold. I mean, it was my research, the work that I put in, spending 2.5 years in solitary.
And really coming to the realization that the Bible was real. So, yeah, we'll get together for sure. This is going to have some legs.
Looking forward to it.
All right, my friend. Have a good rest of your day. We'll be in touch.
Take care. Bye-bye.